Hello everybody. My name is Corey.
And I'm Bracken. And welcome to Triopsychomery Chemistry's first video.
Today we are talking about plastics, specifically where they come from.
So who knows where the main ingredients for almost all of the currently used plastics comes from?
It comes from crude oil pumped out of the Earth's crust from oil rigs in the sea and oil wells on land. The oil is pumped from deep underground into huge storage tanks.
This oil is transported in frankly ludicrously huge ocean-going tankers to oil refineries all around the world. In the refineries, the complex soup of molecules within the crude oil are separated by a property of the molecule called the molecular weight.
The molecules can then be turned into a huge number of products, including fuels such as petrol and diesel for vehicles, engine oil, and the raw ingredients for making plastic. A huge amount of pollution comes from these factories, meaning that plastic production is very bad for the environment.
These raw ingredients used in plastics are called monomers. Each plastic is made from a different monomer that undergoes a special chemical reaction called polymerization to create polymers.
Mono means one, while poly means many. So a polymer is many monomers joined together.
The most commonly used plastics have been conveniently numbered with resin identification codes that you can now see on almost all plastics. So let's go through them one by one, looking at the chemical structure of the polymer and what the plastic is used for.
First up is polyethylene terephthalate, or PET. PET contains two monomeric units, ethylene glycol and terephthalic acid, that react together to form a strong plastic that is commonly used in food packaging and drinks bottles. It is one of the most commonly produced plastic and one of the most valuable for recycling.
Second, and also fourth, are the same plastic. However, they have different densities, high and low density polyethylene. Polyethylene has only one monomer, ethene. High-density polyethylene is used where high tensile strength and low chemical reactivity is needed. This is important to make items such as children's toys, bleach bottles, and pipes used in water mains. Low-density polyethylene is a transparent plastic, usually used to make soft packaging like bubble wrap and carrier bags.
Plastic number three is polyvinyl chloride, more commonly abbreviated to PVC. It is made of a single monomer, chloroethene, or sometimes called vinyl chloride. This is the third most produced plastic in the world and is commonly used in plumbing for household pipes and double glazing window frames. Plastic five is polypropylene, with the monomeric unit propylene. This is a plastic that is strong and has a high melting point, and is incredibly resistant to chemical attack. As such, it is used in products that need to be sterilized regularly in environments for food preparation, laboratory equipment, and medical devices.
Plastic six is polystyrene, whose monomeric unit is styrene. It's most commonly used to make disposable foam coffee cups and takeaway food trays, as well as packaging foam for delicate items. Plastic code seven breaks the trend here though, as it does not relate to any specific plastic. It covers all the other types we make, from other oil-based plastics like nylon and polycarbonate, to plastics from renewable plant-based sources such as polylactic acid.
So those are the different types of plastics. Now let's go back and look at what happens to them once they've been refined from the crude oil to their initial monomers. Take a molecule of ethene, for example. There are two grey carbon atoms connected by a double bond, and connected to each of those carbons are two white hydrogen atoms.
This double bond is strong, so very strong that it requires incredible heat and pressure, and sometimes the presence of a catalyst to break it open. But once that bond is broken, the polymerization reaction can start. The molecule begins connecting to other ethene molecules in a chain reaction to form the long polymer chains.
These get turned into pellets that are shipped to factories where those pellets are turned into plastics.
For our example, the polyethylene is being turned into drinks bottle blanks. They're made narrower than when you see them in the shops, and that makes them easier to store and transport. Once the plastic bottles are on the production line though, they're warmed to their softening point and expanded in a mould using a jet of air.
These newly resized bottles are then filled, sealed and boxed up ready for shipping to shops where they are bought, used and subsequently discarded. If the buyer is the responsible type and puts the bottle in the recycling bin once finished, the bottle will end up in a recycling plant.
The rubbish is put through huge industrial shredders that tear open the bags and break up big clumps of recycling so that they're easier to sort. First, the paper and cardboard are removed, and then with the aid of magnets and incredibly strong electric fields, all of the metal items can then be removed. Then the rubbish passes through a series of scanners that look for specific types of plastics. Once an object made of the desired plastic is detected, it gets blown off the conveyor with a jet of air into a bin.
These sorted plastics are then washed and broken down, either with shredders that mechanically break the plastic into granules, or they are broken down chemically into their original monomers. These are then turned into new materials and products for a different use. Hopefully you will agree that this is a lot better than drilling more oil out of the ground.
That's it for part one, but next time we'll be looking at what happens to plastics that don't make it into recycling bins and end up in the environment. But until then, thank you for listening.
Take care and stay safe.